Well, if you're following these presentations along in the order in which I'm recording them, then this is the 7th presentation, and you may have asked yourself by now, well, he's talking about calculus all the time, but where is the calculus? And really, sometimes the material that we have covered so far I sometimes facetiously call multivariable pre-calculus, because after all, calculus is about limits, derivatives, and integrals, and we haven't looked at any of these concepts yet. That does not mean that what we have done so far is to be trivialized or anything like that. It lays the foundation for the visualization, and the power of calculus then certainly comes from the fact that we will be able to connect the visual concepts to analytical concepts, which will allow us then to do all sorts of really nice physics. We will start in this presentation with limits and continuity. So, although we will mostly use derivatives and integrals in calculus, right? I mean, you've done single variable calculus for about a year, and I'm talking about limits now, and that's way back, hopefully, in the back of your mind, that at some point in time we did do a little bit about limits, and ever so often we talked about limits at infinity. But other than that, limits basically were just the concept that formally underlies derivatives and integrals, and that is not bad. It's just that means limits will also be the formal starting point here. We must start the calculus of vector-valued functions with limits. Limits are cumbersome, we know that, because before we had L'Hopital's rule, limits were really hard to compute, and we were ultimately really glad for the shortcut formulas for differentiation. And even with L'Hopital's rule, sometimes limits can be really, really cumbersome. Thankfully, a lot of the calculus of vector-valued functions can be reduced to doing calculus with the components, and in fact, that's another potential mantra that we're going to repeat quite a bit in this course, and that is whenever you do something with vectors, you typically do it component-wise. So, let's first remind ourselves that really all limits are basically defined the same way, and that is that when the input gets close to the place where we take the limit, the output must get close to the limit itself. So if you want to recall, the definition from single variable calculus was, the informal definition of the limit at a point was, if p is a real number, then the function f is said to converge to the limit L at p, if and only if for all x sufficiently close to but not equal to p, we have that f of x is close to L. And L will be called the limit of the function at p, and that's denoted L equals limit of f of x as x goes to p. Well, the definition for vector-valued functions is going to be exactly the same. So the informal definition of the limit for vector-valued functions is that the vector L is the limit of the vector-valued function C of t at p, if and only if for all t that are sufficiently close to but not equal to p, we have that C of t is close to L. And in symbols, we will write that the limit of C of t as t goes to p is this L. And so visually speaking, if we just take a trajectory of a vector-valued function, and if we then say that this place here, L, is the limit of the vector-valued function, then basically what happens is that we can draw a little circle of radius epsilon around that point, and then for all parameters that are sufficiently close to p, namely for all parameters that are closer to p than delta, and we don't need to have the exact cutoffs here, but for everything that is sufficiently close to p, the curve must be, or the points that are obtained by evaluating the vector-valued function must be within this little circle around the limit. Now, this already goes in the direction of the epsilon-delta definition of the limit, which we are not going to discuss in the mainstream of these presentations, and that is because we have a very simple result that replaces things computationally, and that is the limit of a vector-valued function C of t can be taken component-wise. That is, the limit as t goes to p of C of t is the limit as t goes to p of C1 of t through Cn of t, and again, notice that we don't worry about how many components the vector has. For two dimensions, we would stop it at C2. For three dimensions, we would stop it at C3. And the main thing is that the limit can be moved into the components, so the limit of C of t is the same as if I stack up a vector consisting of the limit of C1 of t, the limit of C2 of t, all the way through the limit of Cn of t. That is how we're going to make a lot of the transitions to multivariable calculus, whenever we have a vector as an output, we will typically apply the operations of calculus component-wise. Which means, so the equation needs to be read as the limit on the left side exists if and only if all limits on the right side exist. But basically, what this means is that we can reduce the vector-valued calculus to single-variable calculus. And the reason for that is, well, if I have, basically, the limit is about closeness, right? So the limit is about the distance between C of T and L. Well, that's, if we write it component-wise, that's about the norm of the difference between C1 of T through Cn of T minus L1 through Ln. And that's the square root of the sum of the squares of the differences. So that norm is the square root of C1 of T minus L1 squared plus C2 of T minus L2 squared and so on all the way through. Well, if C of T goes to L, then for T close to the point where we evaluate the limit, this left-hand side must be small. And so this thing must be small. But if this thing is small, then none of these differences can be small on the right side, can be large on the right side, because then the right side would be large. So that means all these differences must be small. So that means if the vector valued function converges, then all the components must converge, because all these differences must also become small. Conversely, if all the components converge, so if all these individual differences here, here, then certainly also in the dots, and here, if those differences become small, well, then the sum will also be small, and that means that the overall norm of the differences of the vectors must be small. So that means we can replace closeness of the vectors with closeness of the components. The phone rings, I apologize, I need to pause. Okay, well, that pause actually came at the right point, because we're now ready to work out an example that shows that really the computation of limits is just a component-wise computation. And so here we go. If I were to ask you to compute the limit as t goes to 0 of 3 minus 2 t squared minus t over t, and cosine t minus 1 over t, or show that it does not exist, well, we would just have to compute the limit. And what do we remember from computing limits? Well, the 3 minus 2t squared should be no problem at all, because that's where we just plug in t equals 0 and get 3. In this one here, we cannot plug in t equals 0, but we can cancel the t, so this will just be t minus 1. And then we can compute the limit. And for this one, for stuff like this, we had L'Hopital's rule. And if we take the derivative of numerator and denominator here, we should end up with negative sine of t over 1. And, well, that's what we are getting. So we keep the first component, we do algebra in the second component, and we use L'Hopital's rule in the third component, and then we just take the limit component-wise to get 3, negative 1, 0 as the limit, and that's it already. So this is nothing but a review of single-variable calculus. This is just something where we go into the spirit of what we also have to do in multivariable calculus, and that is, when we need it, we simply have to rely on the things that we already have learned, and no matter how deeply they're stored, we have to dig them back out. Now let's talk about continuity, and again, we're going to link the definition of continuity to the definition of continuity that you already know, because again, continuity is always defined the same way. The limit at the point must be equal to the value at the point. So recall, for example, the definition of the limit of a function. If f is a function, then f is called continuous at a, if and only if the following three conditions are satisfied. F of a is defined, the limit as x goes to a, f of x exists, and the limit as x goes to a, f of x must be f of a. And if f is continuous at every point a in the set capital A, then f is called continuous on a. All right, so for a vector-valued function, we will call that thing continuous at a, if and only if the following three conditions are satisfied. C of a must be defined, the limit as t goes to a of c of t must exist, and the limit as t goes to a of c of t must be equal to c of a. So it's exactly the same definition as in one dimension, and what people typically remember is, of course, this equation here. Again, it doesn't highlight too well, but people remember this equation because, after all, that equation implicitly assumes that the first two are satisfied also. And then also the vector-valued function will be called continuous on the set S if and only if it's continuous at every point in the set S, and that leads us to the proposition that makes everything work out like an single variable calculus, and that is a vector valued function C is continuous at A if and only if all its components are continuous at A, and that comes directly from the fact that, of course, limits are taken component-wise. C of A is also evaluated component-wise, which means all of this reduces to conditions on the components, which are just continuity conditions. And a vector valued function is continuous on a set S, well, if and only if all its components are continuous on a set S, because if continuity at A reduces to continuity of the components at A, then the same thing works for sets also. Okay, we're coming to, I think, the final example already. And we want to determine where the function C of t being natural log 9 minus t squared, 1 over 2 minus t, and square root of t plus 1, a three-dimensional vector-valued function where that thing is continuous. Well, we have to look where the components are continuous, and every component is continuous on its domain. The logarithm of 9 minus t squared is continuous on negative 3, 3, and it's not defined outside that domain, right, because we must have that t squared is less than or equal than 9, which happens exactly on negative 3, 3. 1 over 2 minus t, well, what can happen is that you could divide by 0, so you have to exclude 2, so that's continuous on the interval from negative infinity to 2, union the interval from 2 to infinity. And square root of t plus 1 is continuous on the interval negative 1 to infinity, because the radicand, the stuff under the root, must be greater or equal than 0. So basically, determining continuity is again exactly the same as in one variable. We need to figure out where things can go wrong, which are typically negatives where there shouldn't be, such as in square roots or in logarithms, and divisions by 0. And as soon as we exclude those, we've got the place, domains where the components are continuous, and then we just have to intersect these things. So the function C is continuous on the intersection of these domains, which is the interval that starts at negative 1 inclusive, ends at 2 exclusive, and then union 2, 3. Because basically, negative 3, 3, if we intersect that with negative 1 infinity, we get negative 1 to 3, and then we still have to throw away the point 2. And that is already it. So this one was hopefully refreshingly simple. Of course, you have to dig back up what you know about limits, and that may take a minute or so because we haven't worked with limits for a while and then some rust accumulates. But overall, this is now our first step into calculus, and now that we have limits and a formal foundation to define derivatives and integrals, as well as a computational tool or a computational insight that says basically everything ought to work component-wise, we should be able to talk about derivatives and integrals. And that's what the next presentation is about. I'll see you there.